Panel: The Ukraine Crisis. Testing EU-US capacity for a common response and solidarity. Moderated by Mrs. Jelena MILIĆ, Director, Center for Euro-Atlantic Studies, Serbia.
Hello, welcome to the third panel of this great conference. Today, like with all previous panels and the next panels, we have very distinguished lineup of speakers and a tough topic to discuss: Ukrainian crisis and testing the EU-US capacity for common response and solidarity. I'm Jelena MILIĆ. I'm the director of the small think tank from Belgrade, Serbia, Center for Euro-Atlantic Studies. It's my first time actually to work with these Eurovision contest features, tech talk gadgets, and it's my first time to be on this side of the panel. Usually I'm in the audience or as a panelist, so I'm supposed to cut and guide today's panelists, but I encourage them to do the same with me, please. So without further ado, I will invite our panelists to join me today. As you see, we have changed the arrangements slightly. So we have the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Georgia, Ms. Beruchashvili, please join us. We have Ambassador Kobieracki from the Center for Conflict Prevention from the OSCE, the director. Welcome. We have State Secretary, the Romanian Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Podgorean, welcome. We have Mr. KREMENYUK, the Deputy Director of the Institute for American and Canada Studies in the Russian Academy of Sciences. Welcome. And we have Mr. ILLARIONOV, the Cato Institute, United States. Welcome. And last but not least, Ms. Cross, the Director of the Kozmetsky Center at St. Andrew's Center of Woodrow Wilson Center from United States. As you can see, the title of this panel is Ukrainian Crisis and how the EU and the US should and could respond to it. But like with the previous panel, I would like first to lay the ground. What we are talking with, we are talking about Ukraine these days. Are we talking about crisis, conflict, or war? And if we are talking about a war, what kind of war are we talking about? You know, civic war, international war, hybrid war, where we are actually? Without further ado, then, Your Excellency, back in 2008, during the Beijing Olympic Games, what happened in Georgia? And are there similarities between what's going on right now and what happened then? What are the lessons missed, the lessons learned? The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. It is indeed a pleasure to be part of today's panel. Thank you very much to organizers. And first time in Budva, first time at this conference, and discussing issues of security today when the national borders and international rules are challenged. It's a particular exercise. So you are absolutely right. So we discussed the crisis in Ukraine. This is indeed a real war, and the war is a hybrid war with all these components. And international rule and order is challenged. And this is the challenge for European security architecture, which is extremely important for the countries, those who are striving for the European and Euro-Atlantic choice. But I'm here to remind the audience that it's not Ukraine case, it's not a unique case, unfortunately. Everything started much earlier, even beginning of 90s, when Russia fueled two ethnic conflicts in Georgia, Abkhazia and South Ossetia regions. And later, 2008, it culminated into the war and the occupation of 20% of Georgia's territory. Unfortunately, that time, West was, and the general international community failed to adequately assess the situation. And what we face today, that could be seen as a continuation and giving the green light of Russia to go ahead. So what we face today in Georgia is a step towards annexation by the new modalities, signing so-called agreement with independent so-called states of South Ossetia and Abkhazia on association and integration, which are the direct steps towards annexation of sovereign Georgia. And that happened after the annexation of Crimea, and this is the direct continuation of Russia's attempt to expand its spheres of influence and punish those countries who made their independent choice regarding foreign policy.
Thank you very much. Ambassador Kobieracki, the OSCE just published a report yesterday, the Special Monitoring Mission, about the latest, you know, escalation of conflict in eastern Ukraine. I saw also on the internet somewhere a map with the red zones where the OSCE observers are not capable of working properly. So, from your perspective, what's going on right now?
Referring to those red zones, you are absolutely right. It's just yet another proof that OSCE Special Monitoring Mission in Ukraine will be able to do much more if not for the security situation on the ground and lack of access to a large part of the territory that we are supposed to monitor. That's very unfortunate, but that's the fact of life. This is actually this lack of the fact that we might be able to do more is one of the seven features that I want to mention briefly, which make this mission, OSCE mission in Ukraine, a real special mission. It is special, first because it can do more, but is unable to do it because of the realities on the ground. It is special because it is the first case in history where OSCE as an institution is in the lead in the crisis management in the field, supported by EU, supported by other organizations and institutions. And of course, it's not just us who are working on conflict resolution, and there are other institutions involved in that. But in case of deployment in the field and actual crisis management, is OSCE as an institution there. And frankly, when we started to deploy the mission more than a year ago, March last year, I'm in this position, director of the CPC, for 4 years. It was March, April, and May last year when every day I was getting phone calls from Brussels, NATO, EU, everybody. That was a bit of a fun, I must say, for a person working for the OSCE. Thirdly, this is a special mission because it is an OSCE mission, but de facto it works under the political lead of the Normandy format, Normandy Quartet. That's the reality, and we follow through the trilateral contact group and the working groups whatever agreements, arrangements are agreed at the Normandy level. Fourthly, this is a civilian monitoring mission, but it is actually expected to do almost peacekeeping. This is a very false assumption. It's just a civilian monitoring mission. It's an instrument for participating states to use. It's not a peacekeeping operation. Fifthly, it's the biggest and most expensive OSCE mission. That's what makes it special. We authorized to deploy up to 1,000 monitors. We're not yet there, but altogether, with all the staff, it's almost 800 people deployed. And the budget of the mission is almost 90 million euros per year, compared to my budget, CPC, 4.5 million, and compared to the budget of the overall organization, OSCE, with its institutions, which is 141 million euros. That gives you an idea about the size of this event. Second, what makes this mission special is also the fact that it's based on very modern technology. It's a very new experience for us in the OSCE. We are using UAVs, drones. We are also using satellite imagery that we're getting from others. And finally, it is special because it made OSCE very popular again. Even in my home capital in Warsaw, when I was living for the OSCE 4 years ago, there were people who would confuse abbreviations and who would confuse OSCE with OECD. That's not the case anymore.
Do we have Peter Bates right
yeah.
here?
Just one final comment. You know, at the moment, OSCE is involved in crisis management, and we try to contribute, of course, to conflict resolution as far as this crisis in and around Ukraine is concerned. But Equally importantly, when the dust will settle, and if and when a solution to the current crisis will be found, this, I hope, will be for the OSCE to offer, in line with our tradition, to offer OSCE as a framework to rebuild trust and to re-establish a predictable security environment in Europe. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Podgorean, you are actually, I think, the only representative of both the EU and NATO member state. And it's not that the US and EU haven't done anything about Ukraine. The economic sanctions are imposed, and they are not an easy decision. Coming from Serbia for Balkans, it's really the last resort, the one with many collateral damage. But nevertheless, Ambassador highlighted that OSCE mission is not peacekeeping mission, but the allies are doing something. They are going to deploy some more troops in your country this summer. What's going on? Please give us your perspective as a NATO member state as well, representative of the NATO member state. What's going on in Ukraine, and how are the allies responding so far?
Well, thank you. First of all, let me say that I'm very honored to be a part in this forum with such an important topic, and to express my high appreciation to the effort of our host and the excellent organization. It's true. After March 2014, we have here in Europe another world. It's not what we had 20 years before. We moved from a situation when the idea of cooperation was extremely important, and a lot of hope was connected with this evolution. And still, there are a lot of countries in the area which still hope in this kind of approach based on cooperation. But now, after the crisis or war, sure, here it's difficult to say if we have a war, a conflict, or a crisis. Probably at the beginning it was a crisis. But now, I think that we have a hybrid war. Hybrid war means something which we cannot define with a former concept of war, because we don't have formal declaration of war. It's difficult to say who it's in one part and who is in the other part. But there are facts which prove that it is a war. And in this context, sure, we are now coming back, unfortunately, to a moment when the geopolitical ambition seems to be more and more on the front line. I think that this it's something which push us back to some of the strategies which we had in the Cold War era. Sure, it's not something which we like, but we have to act in this framework. And I think that for our country, which is not directly near the area of conflict, but is very close, for our country, which has a border, a large border with Ukraine, and for Romania, which has a Romanian minority in Ukraine, and part of it, it's not too far from the conflict area. What happened there, it is extremely important, and we really worry about that. Now, may I say that we feel better than in all the years which we had the good support of the population for NATO and EU integration, that those were very important decisions. And we are proud that we are now a member of EU and NATO, and we feel that that is very important. We feel the support of both, of the EU, and we feel the support of NATO. We feel the benefit of our strategic partnership with USA. May I say that From the very beginning, the population had the possibility to see that the principle of 28 for 28, it's a real thing in a NATO family. We had the possibility to see Navy capacity, military capacity of NATO being in our area of the Black Sea, which shows us that that our allies took very serious the situation. We are on the way to finalize the anti-missile base in the Veselu. This is somewhere in the south west part of Romania. We are now concentrating our effort in favor of a readiness action plan, which is a, let's say, medium term strategy of NATO. We feel the what we call the reassurance measures of NATO. This means that like in all other, also in other member states in our part of Europe, there are all the time some airplanes from our allies working together with our aviation. We are now looking to the next step to have two headquarters in Romania and Poland, which will be ready to act if something will show that it's need this. These are measures which prove that the Article 5, it's a reality. We are not in the position to use it, but it's a symbolic fact that it is a real unity in the NATO family. In the same time, we are glad to see that it's a very good cooperation between EU and NATO, between EU and United States. All what we want now, with all these measures, some of them military, some of them political, some of them economical, because the economic sanctions are, in my perception, sometimes more important than the military one.
Coming back to economic sanction, this is actually the main distinction between what was going on during the Cold War and what's going on now, you know, because even during the Cold War, you know, we didn't have sanctions. Professor Kremenyuk, a few years ago in one of your great addresses to the audience in Vienna, you reminded the audience about events from the 70s when Johnson met Kosygin, I think, back along the UN conventions in New York, when they decided to agree and disagree on some things, but to work together and move on. Your predecessor mentioned the Cold War. The organizers of this event said that the crisis in Ukraine is the biggest one that we are facing, apart from the Cuban crisis, but in Europe, the and most important one. Fred Kempe, the director of the Atlantic Council of United States, thinks that situation now is tougher than it was during the Cold War. What is your position? Where are we right now?
If I knew, you know, I would have brought to you the recipe what to do else. The situation.
That would be the other set of questions for you, to give us recipes, don't worry.
Okay. Something happened to this microphone.
Exactly. This is what I was instructed to suggest, to use the field microphones.
Yes.
It's on.
Does it work?
Right.
Right.
You know, as soon as Russia comes, you know, the problems.
No, no, no. We people for Balkans are in charge for that here.
Something doesn't work.
Part of the high.
Like this?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, on one hand,
my position was nothing serious is happening, you know, because both sides, I mean Russia and the West, Russia and the United States, they want to keep the situation under control. They want to let it out of some limits. They don't want it to turn into something much worse than it is today. It's evident, and we see, you know, this Mr. Putin received, you know, John Kerry, they discussed the situation. Not everything was, you know, just among them settled, but, you know, no, the process is going. The other side, you know, of course, your question, what do we have? It's a combination of a war, crisis, unmanagement, mismanagement, misunderstanding, and many other things. Because you mentioned, yes, you mentioned Cold War. A month ago, my book has come out in Russian, which is called Lessons in the Cold War. And I'm trying to summarize there, what do we learn? What did we learn from the Cold War? We learned that, of course, we can manage some things, but not everything. We learned that the Cold War, you know, it was, frankly, my naive hope 20 years ago that once the bosses, Gorbachev and Reagan, took the decision, switch off, no more Cold War. Cold War continues. It continues in the minds, it continues among the people, because too many people were interested in the Cold War. They profited from the Cold War. They received money, influence, positions, you know, they were listened to. And for them to stop Cold War is simply impossible. The problem is how, what shape has this Cold War taken, you know? And the shape is one of the worst. Everyone is fighting for peace, which usually, as you understand, will be finished with a big war, if nothing is done, you know, to stop this process. The problem is that, you know, just number one, so the thing which I'm suffering of and which I'm sharing with you. 20 years we cannot find common language with the United States. We found the common language in the worst days of the Cold War. We found it in the nuclear crisis. We cannot find now.
But do you want to find it? Do you want to find it?
I didn't.
Does Russia want to find it?
Oh, why not?
I'm asking you.
We are normal people as all the others, you know, we want, you know. So many times we suggested to discuss this, to discuss this, to discuss this. But very often, you know, just it was either blind eye turned to us or simply, you know, just they didn't understand what we wanted. Because I say, you know, of course Russia understood. Russia has come through a very difficult period in its life. 70 years of terror, 70 years of fear, 70 years of psychopathology. And now Russia wants to be as all the other nations. It wants to be a European, it wants to be, you know, just a normal, it wants to follow general lines, but it cannot. It cannot because of the structures, because of the agencies, because of the institutions that we have, because of many things, you know. Just look now with the regard or with the interconnection with the Ukrainian crisis. So many people have turned out, you know, almost Nazi, you know. They are so radical. They are ready to kill their opponents. They are ready to kill Ukrainians.
Professor.
It's a horrible thing, you know. Just, and
Professor. Would you mind if I cut you short right here, because speaking about, you know, violent extremism,
mind.
Because I will come back to all the panelists with the other round of questions, if it's okay
I
with you.
I hope so, because I have only began.
Good. Deal. Professor Cross, speaking about extremism and how to combat it, a few years ago, after the occupation of Georgian territories and before, you know, Ukraine, war in Ukraine, you put out an excellent article about combating violent extremism in Russia, in social media and elsewhere. But this article is also a nice breakdown of the shift, you know, which Putin administration at one moment assumed to derail from the EU values and practices and to abuse the fight against extremism for fight against political opponents, etc. But nevertheless, despite all these things that you have identified in this article, you suggest that the cooperation has to go on. Mm-hmm. Now, with Ukrainian war in Ukraine, what are you thinking?
Well, thank you for the question. And first of all, I want to say a special thanks of gratitude to the organizers of this conference and the Atlantic Council, and particularly Savo Kentra. I had the privilege of being involved with the 2BS forum and working with Savo and his colleagues from the very inception of this idea. And I knew that it would be successful with the kind of leadership and commitment that they had here. And I think it's a real testimony and tribute to the dedication and the effort that has been put forth into Montenegro and the society to be able to host such a terrific event and provide this forum for us to discuss these important issues. And it's a little bit more difficult for me to be here now because I had a short trip from Garmisch-Partenkirchen, and there's a little bit more involved coming from the United States, but I'm delighted to be here, and I think it's very important, and I'm hopeful about things that we can continue to do in the future. Let me answer one thing first, because you asked us what, I think the circumstances in Ukraine can be described as a tragedy. Thousands of casualties, people's lives that have been dislocated and disrupted. It's going to take years and years to recover from this conflict, this war, that is really about the geostrategic future of the country, the cultural identity and heritage, and how the Ukrainian population sees the development of their nation. And while we talk about the global chessboard and nations being up for grabs, people are suffering. And I think we need to keep that in mind. And we need to remember our humanity, and we need to think long and hard about how we can try to find common ground and move this forward in a more positive direction. You know, I worked on this continent for a decade, going from country to country, and was in Ukraine a lot, in the Caucasus and Southeastern Europe. And it would be so much better if our resources could be devoted to enhancing capacity, building capability, institutions, economic and political structures, and contributing to the security of people's lives. We were headed in the right direction, talking about the common European security community from both the Russian side and the opportunity that was given to us by the transition from the Soviet Union, what those architects of the end of the Cold War and those who did a lot, Mikhail Gorbachev, number one, and those Western leaders who gave us a chance to try to build something better, and I'm afraid we're squandering it. Because you cannot talk about European security ignoring the Russian factor. Now, I understand totally and completely, and by the way, this is supposed to be a forum of controversy and raising out-of-the-box thinking, but I'm kind of asking us to look at the long-term vision. This is a nuclear superpower, a major power in world politics. We may not like everything, it's difficult to deal with, but yes, I think we have to do the hard work of staying on track and trying to work through these problems in a way that's constructive for Europe, for Eurasia, and the broader world. And I'm very concerned about this tendency, maybe not even to go back into something like the Cold War, which was very predictable. This is more of an unpredictable, potential hot war.
An unpredictable war? We have Professor Ilarionov here. Dr. Ilarionov, would you mind if I cut you short now and pass the floor to Dr. Ilarionov?
Please come back to us and give us a chance, because like Professor KREMENYUK, I just started.
Deal. Don't worry about it. You mentioned that what's going on in Ukraine is a tragedy. It's about 6,500 casualties so far and several hundred internally displaced persons, you know, already. But is it a premeditated tragedy? Can we compare it with a boat that just, you know, sank in China or with the destiny of Rohingya? Dr. Ilarionov, I saw your presentation in the Atlantic Council. You have compelling evidence that it was a premeditated war. So tell us a little bit more about it.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. This is a great privilege and pleasure to be here. But let me start from the some words that you have mentioned, as well as Mr. KREMENYUK has also mentioned. The term Ukrainian crisis, or crisis in Ukraine. This is a great invention of Kremlin propaganda and a great achievement, because not only in Russian mass media, but internationally, this term is being used widely instead of the very clear term war, Russian-Ukrainian war. Instead of clearly saying about the two parts, two parties are participating in this war, the phrase or the term Ukrainian crisis is kind of shifting the attention to internal domestic issues, which is not partially exist, but certainly not the full picture. I have seven small points here, and I will just mention them without any argumentation. This is definitely war. This is a Russian-Ukrainian war, and this is third war in this presidency. Russian-Chechen war, Russian-Georgian war, Russian-Ukrainian war, and one war, full-fledged wars, and one war that did not happen in Kyrgyzstan in year 2000, in 2010. And I think it is important to keep in mind, because this particular example gives us very important lessons how we might stop the war at the very early stages. Second, this is definitely war against Ukraine, and it's a very premeditated war. It started, we can trace different stages, and in the Atlantic Council presentation I mentioned some of them. We definitely can trace it from at least assassination of Vyacheslav Chernobyl in March 1999 near Kyiv. This is the very first strike of this war. It was 16 years ago, and many others. Third point, this is war not only against Ukraine, this is war against Europe. Many points can be used here. I would mention just one. Recently, a Russian Minister of Foreign Affairs has introduced a blacklist for 89 Europeans, among them such people like Jerzy Buzek, former president of Europarlament, Karel Schwarzenberg, former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Czech Republic, Bernard-Henri Lévy, legendary person. So it's just a war against European intellectual elite from all spectrum, from all political and intellectual spectrum. Fourth, this is war against the West, and I would say to some extent towards the modern civilization, against values, against the rules, because it's a violation of more than half of dozens of international treaties, agreements, United Nations Charter, Helsinki Act, bilateral treaty between Russia and Ukraine, Budapest Memorandum, and so on. This is international order that exists from 1945 in Europe, and this is a war against this international order. Fifth, it is definitely, it's a hybrid war, but this is a conventional war. Hybrid war has been started on July 27th, year 2013. It has been announced by Mr. Putin in Kyiv. The conventional war has been started on February 20th, year 2014, with an attack on Crimea. But this is a very important. This is a new war. Cold War ended in December 1991, and this is a new one. Actually, some people from Kremlin saying that it is a fourth world war. We can talk about whether it's true or not. Sixth, it's very important element. This is also information war and disinformation war at the level that we have not seen in the history of civilization. And this war does not have borders, does not have boundaries. It is everywhere. My last 7 points, it is just beginning. It's not the end, and it's not going to end anytime soon. I'd like to mention that whole campaign against Ukraine last year has been waged with the military expenditures of Russia at level about 4% of GDP. The beginning of this year saw military expenditures of Russia now at 10% of GDP. 10% of GDP military expenditures, it is not for Debaltseve. It is not for Ilovaisk. It is not for Ukraine. Stay tuned.
Wow. A bleak assessment. I will come back to all of you. Very bleak assessment with this point that this is just the beginning. Unfortunately, there are many in the West who agree with you. Damon Wilson, the executive vice president of the Atlantic Council, wrote just a few days ago when they announced and published their report in the plain sight, Putin's war in Ukraine. And what I found interesting is we didn't mention Russia formally. There is no mentioning of Russia, the title of this panel. We didn't mention Mr. Putin until Mr. Ilarionov said he, but somehow we came back to the Russia. And Mr. Wilson writes that the conflict in Ukraine's east is a Kremlin-manufactured war begun by Russian officials, fought by Russian soldiers, fueled by Russian equipment, and supported by artillery strikes from Russian territory. The evidence is literally hiding in a plain sight. Okay, we may agree or disagree on that, but there is a need for common response and solidarity, apparently. I think that there is no disagreement about that, at least. So what we have at the moment at the table and what should be done in the future? I know that these are very tough questions, but this is the obligation to address them. I suppose then when we are talking about US-EU response, that the organizers also assume that we are talking about existing structures like NATO, which exist among transatlantic partners. And I dare say it's also a war against transatlantic partnership, not only war against Europe. And that they are just doing fine, you know. We have problems. The EU is, remember, definitely more relaxed periods when it was not facing the Greek crisis, the possible, you know, exit of the UK, when it's not stretched in the Middle East with immigrants. The US as well is doing fine, is drilling more gas and oil than ever, but it's also stretched in. We have several panels already about it. So both political entities, EU and US, are stretched in. But the crisis in Ukraine, unfortunately, you know, is going to go on. So what do we do? What do we do from a Georgian point of view?
So this is extremely important how West together will respond to these challenges and how responsibly that would react, because I fully agree with all these 7 points of Mr. Ilarionov. And I believe this is the proper diagnosis of the situation, which is so important to identify further actions and probably not to develop immediate recipe for the solution, but make right steps. And on that direction, I want to particularly stress importance of persistency, consistency, and the unity of the West, and strong cooperation among US and the European Union. That will be decisive to use all the relevant instruments. We are not for military confrontation, but we believe that Russia has to pay a relevant price, both economic, as well as the moral price, political price, for everything that was done in Georgia, is doing in Ukraine and elsewhere. Because otherwise, what is at stake? It's the total erosion of international rule and order. And this is extremely important for a small country like Georgia. And plus, in parallel, the countries, those who made their choice, they have to be given opportunity to embrace their European and Euro-Atlantic choice using different modalities, and that has to be done in a timely and efficient way.
There could be an entire panel on how that is, yes, you know, a challenge in Balkans and suffocated in Balkans. But I would like just to ask the organizers, when should I open the floor for the public, for the questions and answers? It's 4:20 now. Do I have another 10 minutes with panelists? I hope so. Ambassador, are the OSCE limits already tested? Can the OSCE do more? Do we need new structures? What's going on with the, you can't speak about it, I suppose, with the, you know, with the Security Council. We have an ongoing trade negotiation between the United States and the EU, and I think that all countries involved should think, you know, about the outcome if this trade negotiation becomes successful. Mm-hmm. Would they like to be part of that world and, you know, or the rest, and the OSCE is somehow in the middle? Is there a room for more OSCE, or is it just moving away as an actor like Security Council did?
OSCE, of course, can do more, but don't forget, OSCE, I mean, we have a rule of consensus, and we have 57 participating states, including Russian Federation. So there are certain obvious political limits. In terms of what needs to be done, there are two things, short-term and longer-term. Short-term, of course, fighting must stop, and political process, real political process must take place, must start concerning this crisis, war, whatever politically correct terminology. Longer term, however, I absolutely disagree that we need to manipulate with European security structures. We have more structures, institutions, organizations than we need. We don't need yet another discussion about pan-European security treaty or security treaty or whatever. What didn't work was that all the rules, norms, principles that we agreed were violated. We need to make sure that norms, principles, values are respected, observed, and implemented.
Thank you. Thank you. Very healthy and, you know, down to the point recipe. Mr. Podgorean.
Yes, may I focus just for a few minutes on something which we consider NATO must do for the security of Europe. It's the, to keep the NATO open door policy. It's something very important. I think that I really hope that at the end of this year we shall have a positive decision for Montenegro.
That is a triumph. For the first time we mentioned, you know, possible Montenegro membership in an hour after the beginning of the panel, so I'm meaning.
But surely.
And may I say that this is not important only for Montenegro, it's important for the NATO, because we need new members, we need members which agree with our values, and I think this is something which will help the security on the continent.
Thank you. In preparation for this panel, I came across several excellent reports and suggestions how to move on, and maybe the best paper that I have read in this short period is the new German Marshall Fund paper on how Ukraine and NATO should structure their cooperation better. Of course, the suggestion to maintain open door policy is there, but there are also obligations to the aspiring sides as well. Maybe to take with more concern and seriousness, you know, the democratic processes, you know, in their countries as well. Professor KREMENYUK, I cut you short. Here is your chance to tell us, what is your suggestion? How do we move on from this extremely tough situation?
I think that I should begin again thanking, you know, my gratitude to you for the invitation, which I didn't mention, you know, for the first time. And congratulations that you have managed to put in one basket absolutely different questions. You know, OSCE,
I am also
Romania,
invited.
Yeah.
The organizers should even take credit for that.
And even two Russians who adhere to different views. Everything is here. Typical Europe.
You were not here during the first panel. We had several Serbs, you know, discussing the global position of NATO.
Let me continue,
this is life. You know, this is
because
reality.
I know that you will torpedo me at any point. You know, you know, to some extent, I do agree with Mr. Ilarionov. Yes, it's not a war of Russia. It's nothing. It's a nonsense, you know. A general crisis of the current system, which has started with the end of the Cold War, with the attempts of the United States to take the position of the only leader of the world, which failed. And what we have now is the growth of the new centers like China, Russia including, by the way, you know, and some others, while still we have very strong residues of the previous world order. This is the real essence, you know, of the crisis in Ukraine also. There is a crisis in Ukraine, but this is not simply a crisis between Russia and Ukraine, you know. I don't see that, you know, they really cannot get to any agreement. They do, they can, they will, inevitably. The problem is really, you know, that the world is changing. And some people don't want to recognize it. Some nations don't want to recognize it. They still want to keep everything as it was for decades. The other nations feel that the world is changing and they are trying to think about the future. So I think that this is one of the very important moments of the current period in the world politics. you know, these two trends. One trend is to keep as it was, and the other trend to change. Well, and of course, you know, just every nation uses what it has. Those who have money use money. Those who have guns use guns. This is a, you know, a typical thing for the human history. Nothing new in it. The problem is what we can do now is to bring them together, because all of them want to control what is happening. They are afraid that at some point the events will go out of control, and then it will be the situation which I love to tell to my students, which one of the American authors has written, when in the summer of 1914 the events were going toward the European war, and Kaiser Wilhelm demanded, you know, Moltke, stop it, and he said, unmöglich, you know, you have unleashed the events which you cannot control. This is the thing, I think, that really gives me a hope that, yes, of course, we are moving in different directions. Yes, of course, we have different values. And yes, of course, you know, we live in different worlds. Still, at the same time, you know, there are elements of some reason, there are elements of some understanding of the seriousness of the situation which brings them together. I mentioned to you, I completed the book on the history of the Cold War. And there was these elements, you know, when Khrushchev, the communist, Stalinist, you know, just came together with Kennedy and said, yes, we should stop it. He understood, and that understood different people, absolutely hostile people. Still, they understood the importance of what they were talking about. So I think that in this sense, we can cope, including, you know, the gatherings like yours, you know, that we are coming to some sort of consensus which will not be imposed by anyone. The attempts to impose on Russia something, you know, they're ridiculous, frankly, you know, because Putin simply snails at them, you know, just, and the Russians are doing what they want. The problem is, of course, you know, just to help to the Russians to come to very, very, I'd say, constructive positions, because Putin understands he needs strong economy, he needs happy people, he needs strong law, he needs many things which are not existent in the current Russia, but they can be achieved if he receives understanding on the other side. So far, he didn't receive. Well, but that didn't make him, you know, just pessimistic. More than that, you know, you feel, you may read, you know, that more than 80% of the population support him. They still believe that he can change their lives.
I have to be Kaiser William now, I'm sorry. Hmm? I have to torpedo you again. Sorry.
Yeah, I thought from the very beginning you have something.
We are going, yeah. No, yes. We are going to conduct it later on, you know. I have received several subtle suggestions that I have to wrap it up until 5 p.m. Apparently there is something outside. I don't know what, you know. There is something gorgeous outside. Professor Cross, Professor Kremenyuk mentioned China. You are just writing a book about 21st geopolitics. Can you give us a preview? Is there a remedy for what we are talking about right now, the war in Ukraine, in your writings? How do you see the EU and the United States and all the occupied structures that we have mentioned should act?
I mean, this is a huge, we could sit here for the next 5 hours to answer that responsibly. Let me concentrate. You asked about what should be done. So let me concentrate briefly on the NATO aspect of it. Because obviously the NATO-Russia relationship has been at the center of the European security architecture, and it will continue to be the way it plays out, the relationship between NATO and Russia. And there's a few things that, and I think NATO's in a process now that they're looking at the circumstances and thinking about potential responses. First of all, it's obviously very critical to reassure apprehensive allies. This is very important. What does Article 5 mean? It's a serious guarantee. It means something. General Larionov's points that he made about the complexity of the warfare, information dimensions and everything, we have to work out and decide what constitutes an intervention. At what point do we? This is a very critical issue that has to be discussed. At the same time, we have to be very careful that while reassuring allies, we are not unnecessarily provoking consequences that none of us intend or desire. We need very clear channels of communication, which I'm worried about, at the mill-to-mill level, at the political level, so that in this time of uncertainty, there's not a situation where there's misunderstanding, misperception, miscalculation, accidents that could lead to very serious unintended consequences. In this issue of the Russians, for example, buzzing US ships that go on every other day, close encounters in the skies, at what point do you have a serious incident like this that escalates into something much bigger? Again, remember, you're dealing with a major circumstance with a nation with a lot of power and influence, and we've got to be careful about this and be mindful of what we're doing. As far as relationship of NATO and Russia, NATO can't work with Russia if Russia doesn't want to do that.
You mentioned that in your articles.
In the current circumstances,
NATO can be protected from Russia, from the missiles coming from the east.
Well, a lot of time is going to have to go by and pass in this, and I think you remain open to engagement, and you see what happens. Of course, if you look at the strategic interests of the NATO alliance and the NATO members and the Russian Federation, and we share so many common critical security challenges that are jeopardized by the current deterioration of the circumstances. Let's stay focused on the big vision. In the United States and NATO, we need to think long term. What do we want with Russia? What is our end state and how to get there? Instead of being stuck in the weeds and what's happening day to day and pointing at who's right and who's wrong, look at the big long-term objectives.
But you are writing about the fact that the best way to achieve the bigger picture, like I suppose the Europe whole, free and in peace, is the most potent weapon we have is democratization and empowerment of citizens, you know.
Yes, and but I think as far as this issue of enlargement, I mean, I agree, the door should remain open. I do not think, and I don't think anyone would suggest that Ukraine is a candidate for NATO membership anytime soon. Of course, NATO can be very helpful and continue to provide practical support, cooperation, but it's going to be a long process to recover from this war, for the Ukrainian society to sort out their identity and conflicts, and to build the capacity needed. As far as Montenegro goes, I think the door is open. Russia should not have a veto authority over whether Montenegro is in NATO. But one point that I made over and over again in the 10 years that I was on this continent, there should never have been a need for a choice. Countries like Ukraine, Montenegro, Georgia, they should have never been put in a position where they have to choose between their traditional relationship with their Eastern partners and deeper integration in the Euro-Atlantic community. They should have been able to have both. But these narratives and what Professor KREMENYUK said about this lingering Cold War mentality, that we really just never could overcome that. We couldn't see new opportunities. And there's guilt on both sides on this. And as a result, we have a much more difficult security circumstances, resources being used in ways that we have to now start preparing how to combat one another than thinking about how we can strengthen and enhance our collective security and prepare ourselves for the 21st century. This is a different world. We work on China. Yes, the challenges are immense. They're transnational. We have to work together.
Thank you. Thank you. Professor, Dr. ILLARIONOV, I will give the floor now to you. I will ask you something and then I will open the question and answer session. According to my math, we have time until 5 and 10. I suppose it's okay with the organizers. Professor KREMENYUK mentioned that Putin knows very well what people of Russia need and want. I'm not so sure, frankly. I don't know whether we can actually establish what. How can we help and empower people of Russia to become part of the solution rather than part of the problem? People like Boris Nemtsov, who was compiling evidence which suggests that Russia is directly involved in a war in Ukraine. Professor Cross just mentioned that countries shouldn't be forced to choose. I suppose, you know, again, coming from Serbia, being one of the positive examples of the nonviolent regime change from the authoritarian to more democratic and progressive one, we need assistance, we need help. At least this is, you know, Western Balkans experience. So how do we move from current situation? How do we reach out and help those in Russia who genuinely want democratization, human rights, rule of law?
Just to check the statement, whether Mr. Putin does know Russian society or not, let's just remind how many people were on the streets of Moscow in the day of inauguration of Mr. Putin. None. All streets have been cleaned and emptied. It showed that Mr. Putin does not want to know what people think, and he doesn't know what they really think. It's a very clear manifestation of absolute absence of any desire to understand what Russian society is about. Second, Professor Kremenyuk was talking about Nikita Khrushchev. But here's the problem. We're dealing not with Nikita Khrushchev. We're dealing with Vladimir Putin. It's a very big difference. We're dealing not with the CPSU. We're dealing with a corporation of secret police officers. It's a very big difference. What to do in this particular situation? Let me make a very clear statement. There is no non-military solution to this war. If you'd like, I can repeat again. There is no non-military solution. Those who say that there is no military solution and arguing for some kind of peaceful measures that we all advocate for, giving the opportunity for military measures to Mr. Putin, doing nothing. And Mr. Putin is very happy for this opportunity, and he's using military means when the other side is limiting itself with military measures. If you yourself, with your wife or with husband, depending on your gender, with your kids, bump in the dark alley in the night with a bunch of criminals with very clear intentions, you certainly can advise them to read Bible, or Quran, or Talmud, or preach peace, or very good relations. But if you would not fight, you would fail with your wife or kids or so on. So there is only one way to stop it, is just to fight, to resist. And there are several very clear, practical, historical examples how it happened, not in the Bible, not in the history of our generation, but just right now, a few years and even a few months ago. Do you know how it has been stopped offensive for the Russian troops against Tbilisi during the Russian-Georgian war? On August 11th, year 2008, all Russian troops in the South Caucasus, in Ossetia, in Abkhazia, Armenia military base, Black Sea Fleet, everywhere, have been united under one command, and the command of General Shamanov. And General Shamanov has been appointed as the commander-in-chief with very clear order to take Tbilisi, to remove Georgian government, and to hang Mr. Saakashvili. So, and Russian tanks started to roll to Tbilisi. What happened after that? Certainly, Georgians gathered on the Rustaveli Avenue, the several presidents of European countries flew to Tbilisi. There was manifestation, protestation, but Russian tanks rolled to Tbilisi.
Now I have to cut you short just to be impartial toward the Russians here.
The National Security Council of the United States decided, make some decision, and Mr. Bush decided something, and they sent US Navy into the Black Sea and the US Air Force to Romania and to Turkey. All these movements have been detected through the night, and next day, on August 12th, Mr. Medvedev appeared on TV screens and said, all our targets in Georgia are achieved. We stop our offensive. Very similar happened in year 2010 in Kyrgyzstan, when two Russian paratroop regiments have been landed in Osh Valley with very clear attempt to start another war over there. But there was a telephone call from Chinese president who said, I don't want it. 3 days ago, all paratroopers have been returned back to Moscow. So, and another case, if Mr. Obama, last February, last March, would behave something similar as Mr. Bush did in year 2008, the war against Ukraine, against Europe, against the world, would be stopped in Crimea. And Crimea, at this moment, would still be Ukrainian. And there will be no war in Donbas. And there will be no 6,500 people being killed
Thank
during
you.
This war.
Let's now give our audience opportunity to ask this brilliant panel questions. Dan, izvolite.
Thank you, Jelena. My name is Professor Dejan Miletic from Belgrade. I am leading Center for Globalization Studies. I'm asking myself one serious thing because Serbia had in a former period of time the person like Mr. Putin. And I would like to ask Professor Kremenyuk, because I know that he's introduced in a secrets, deep secrets of Russia, to ask himself, his friends, whether Mr. Putin is working for NATO.
For NATO?
For NATO, yes, because NATO right now tied their structures, built their institutions more thoroughly, get sense, and also Mr. Putin is going on a former Milosevic path, you know, he's having 80% of the popularity in the Russia, Milosevic also, and made the greatest damage to Serbia that can even imagine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, microphone is yours. Here you are. We meet again.
No, thank you. Beautiful question. Beautiful.
Does the microphone work?
The brief answer, no. He doesn't care about NATO. Let me say so. You know, for him, this is something ancient, from, say, 50 years old, which has very little relevance to the current situation and the current processes. But, you know, it's still there. And for Russian propaganda, it's a beautiful, beautiful subject, you know, just, look at them. What that? They cannot do much, you understand. It failed in Afghanistan. It will fail everywhere. Militarily, it's not a problem. But there is a problem, I say, you know, just, you mentioned one thing, yes. And several years ago, there was a special group of experts, Russian-American, headed by Henry Kissinger and Evgeny Primakov. And we met regularly in Moscow, in Washington. We met the presidents, we reported to the presidents, you know. So I think that to some extent, I know something which maybe Mr. Larionov doesn't know. The problem is how carefully they're planning their steps. Sometimes, of course, you know, it was on the verge of some mistake, but usually, no. A big game, yes. Sometimes tragic games, yes, because, you know, just every mistake could lead, you know, to very grave consequences. And everyone understood, and we understand. So, but nevertheless, you know, just, there was a kind of game. It was unfortunately ended when Mr. Obama has come to power, because Obama personally attacked Putin and was not terribly polite. For Mr. Putin, that was a deadly insult, and since then, he doesn't wish even to talk to Obama. He has sometimes to, but he doesn't want. So the problem is, you know, now how to deal with Europe, isolating the United States. Why NATO? From this point, you are right. Yes, he works for the NATO.
Do we have more questions? Please just introduce yourself. I don't see you from here. Okay. There is one in the back, and then we'll come back to the first row.
My name is Cedar Ajacic, Editor-in-Chief of Army Info Forum, Specialized Media. I have a question for Mr. Kremenyuk. Lady from your website, from Georgia, tell us that Russia must pay for everything in Abkhazia, Ossetia, etc., etc. But I have a question for you. Will NATO pay for Libya, Syria, Iran, Iraq? That is question for you. Question for Lady Cross. You tell us that Russia must be that must be pay attention about Russia attitude and Russia interest. What will be happen in next 2 or 3 years if that don't if that is not count like a change of politics of NATO or EU? What will happen if nobody care about Russia interests? Thanks.
Professor?
Ladies the first.
Go ahead. Well, I mean, the point I made is that I think we have to take, as in, you know, any kind of responsible thinking about foreign policy to take account of the interests of different parties and think about how you can find common ground and move toward more productive solutions on things. Again, there's a lot of shared, very important security interests. We need the Russians' cooperation in a number of areas. One of the big threats you guys are talking about here is the challenges presented by terrorism, by ISIL, that they're presenting in the world. This is an area where we have a common interest. I think we need a broad-ranging security agenda. I totally agree with the panel that to the extent that the United States, Europe, the transatlantic community can stay on the same page and pursue a common strategy and policy with respect to Russia, the more effective. But at the same time, we should keep a broad range and we should avoid hinging the relationship on any single issue. This was one of the big problems with missile defense. We set it up as a game changer. There were obviously differences of priorities and interests involved, and yet we said this can change the relationship, and to the extent that you can't succeed, it threatens everything else that you have where you have common interests and you can work together. That's the kind of things that we need. And what kind of bothers me in a way too is we're tending to look at the current circumstance just in the immediate environment without the larger context. How did we get to this point? How have we seen this kind of deterioration in the European security community? I think the Ukrainian crisis was predictable given previous conflicts in Kosovo and Georgia, but I think what we didn't see is how far the circumstances can deteriorate. And I disagree with you that I don't think that you could predict with certainty how the military campaign would play out in Ukraine. President Putin put the nuclear forces on alert over Crimea. How can you be sure how it would play out? So, I mean, saying war is the solution and somehow you don't understand how terrible the world is if you want to talk about peace and the Bible and the Quran, I fundamentally disagree with you. We've got to find a better way of doing things in the 21st century. We had an opportunity and we're squandering it, and the generations to come would pay the price for it. So, that's my concern.
Okay, speaking about prices, there was a question about whether NATO should pay for Africa was mentioned.
There was a question also to me, just I'll try it, but I'll be brief. there is nothing, as unfortunately, absolute in this world. And the return of the great power rivalry is accompanied with some growing, unfortunate disrespect of the smaller nations. You may see it, you know. So from point of view, sometimes you may see, just the question was Mr. Putin, his attitude to Georgia, his attitude towards Abkhazia, and so on, so on. Game, it's the cards for the game, you know. Just he keeps them. Why he doesn't recognize or does not include Abkhazia into Russia? Too early, too early. He still thinks of the maybe future discussion, future dialogue with Georgia. For that purpose, he needs to keep some cards at his side, you know. So, you know, but of course, you know, sometimes it creates divisibility, you know. Simply the big powers play games with the smaller powers. It's one of the very strong elements, especially among the nations, like, for example, Montenegro, you know, a small nation, independent, but at the same time, always the people would feel or think, look, they are disregarding us, or, you know, they do not respect us. You know, it's a typical thing. So from this point of view, I think that simply what we have sometimes on the surface is again return to the rules of the beginning of the 20th century. The big powers amuse and enjoy themselves.
There was a question from the first row, yes?
Can I make a comment?
Oh, of course. Would you mind if we let our guest from Georgia Ms. Berushashvili.
So I want to stress that this is too cynical comparison that big powers have an opportunity and of the possibility to play cards with small countries. So if we continue on that way, we are risking to revisit everything that we so much cherish and that our value-based partnership and value-based societies are based. So I think it's extremely risky exercise. Vice versa, we have to find ways, and all big powers should have an interest, responsibility, and also work together, those who really base their partnership on the values, because this is the most important. Otherwise, coming back to the old-fashioned thinking will completely destroy what was gained with such a, you know, very powerful times and the efforts. And also coming back about making choice. So if choice is made, and Georgian and Ukrainian people, they made their choice, and their choice is value-based, also international rule and order-based European and Euro-Atlantic community. If this choice is made, and this choice is not against anyone, nobody should have a veto right over this choice. And this is the only opportunity to expand area of peace, prosperity, and democracy in the region. That's why open door policy is extremely important. And all these countries, those who are able, willing, capable, and sacrifice their efforts, human rights, they have to be given opportunity to proceed on that direction.
Thank you. Let us give the chance to one of our participants who would like to pose a question, and then I would give the floor back to Mr. ILLARIONOV, and then we can wrap. Here you are.
Thank you very much. Basat Öztürk from Turkey, Director General for International Security Affairs. My point would be about NATO's collective defense commitments. I think it cannot be taken like... my comment will be about NATO's collective defense commitments. I think they cannot be taken lightly. It has never been tested before because it is a serious commitment on the part of the allies. And in my opinion, that's why many countries now are trying to join NATO as soon as possible because they feel they will be assured with NATO's security umbrella. In my opinion, in this region, no single country in the Balkans will be able to be a member of the European Union before being a member of NATO, because the European Union is not in a position to assure the security of its member states, whereas NATO is. So in my opinion, such things like the annexation of Crimea is reinforcing this sentiment that these countries are rushing, I agree with you therefore, is rushing to become members of NATO. Thank you.
Thank you. I will give floor now to Mr. ILLARIONOV, then to Ambassador, and I will give opportunity to all the panelists to wrap up and to conclude this panel.
I think that's a deep misunderstanding of logic, of nation, of nature, of intentions of the current Kremlin leadership. It is a deep misunderstanding of the so-called Putin's doctrine, which is essentially states of limited or non-existent sovereignty of the smaller states neighboring Russia, whether it is Georgia, whether it is Ukraine, or Moldova, or Baltic countries, or Belarus, or Kazakhstan, or any other country. According to this doctrine, any of those countries has no right to choose either domestic system of governance or political foreign political orientation, whether they have right to join EU, NATO, or any other organization, or any other alliance. And that is why, just if any of those countries demonstrate interest or willingness to join any of these alliances, Mr. Putin and Kremlin leadership is threatening to use force, and if it is not enough, using the force. This is the Putin's doctrine. And that is why denial of any of those countries' right to choose its destiny, including denial of Ukraine to join NATO, is exactly playing in the hands of Mr. Putin's policy. That's a very, very clear. That is why saying Ukrainian crisis instead of Russian-Ukrainian war is repeating Putin's propaganda. It's a very, very clear. And probably very important point here about the military, non-military solution. When Mr. Bush sent US Navy to Black Sea, and he sent US Air Force to Romania and Turkey, none, I repeat, none of US soldiers happened to be in Georgia. There was no boot on the soil. No, there was no military operation on Georgian soil, but it was a demonstration of willingness, of interest, and desire, and readiness, if it is necessary, to defend Georgia from international aggression and intervention. The very same story happened in Kyrgyzstan in the year 2010. The very same story happened, actually, which is not very many people know, in April last year, during the conversation between the former minister or the Secretary of Defense, Chuck Hagel of the United States, and Sergei Shoigu, Minister of Defense on Russia. That time, it was the height of the so-called Novorossiya military operation, when Novorossiya was under attack from the Russian supported forces. And that time, Mr. Chuck Hagel said, okay, if you'd like to demonstrate who is stronger, we're moving the NATO infrastructure towards the Russian borders. We started to train people there. We will start the operation reassurance for our allies. What was the response to these words, not actions? For next month, there was no activity, military activity of the Russian forces on Ukrainian territory, near Ukrainian territory.
Thank you.
And if the words of Mr. Hagel would be translated into some real actions, there would be no continuation of military operation. But after seeing for 30 days that there is no real activity on the ground, so Mr. Putin say, okay, we'll continue. So that is very clear. Just you need to understand the nature of the person whom you're dealing with. If you're trying to some kind of to preach to some very good principles, but if those principles are not supported with actions, you are failed.
Okay, principles, actions, we have somehow to bring it to the closure. Ambassador Kobieracki, you wanted to intervene.
Two comments, one personal, one in my OSCE capacity. The personal comment is that having listened to the comments, or suggestions rather, that we, the West, we should help Russia to find a relevant position on the geographic, or the European landscape. We have to understand Russia, and we have to, we can't take the risk of breaking relations with Russia, even on controversial issues. I would assume that those who suggest this take for granted that at a similar event like we have now here today, anywhere in Russia, there are recommendations coming from the participants. We Russians have to understand the West. We Russians have to help the West understand us. And we Russians cannot take the risk of breaking relations with the West because of controversial issues. It takes two to tango. That was the personal comment. On as the OSCE representative, having also listened to the comments, I'm coming to the conclusion that I have no idea should I be happy about it or not, that OSCE as a security institution seems to be one of the few, if not the only one, relic of the Cold War still tolerated in Moscow. Thank you.
Other panelists, do you have?
Please. Few words. I think that in our opinion, always a political solution is possible, and a stronger NATO is part of a political solution.
Thank you.
I need to defend my profession, you know, that we have the whole group of the academic institutes. One of them is about 500 people, researchers, the others are 150 and so on, who deal professionally with the studies of the West, of the Western decision making, of the Western political process. This is simply to answer to our colleague, you know, from the OSCE, that these efforts were undertaken many years ago, maybe 40 years. My institute was established in 67. You know, some others were earlier. So around this time, about we had this body of knowledge. And I can assure that not all, but many decisions were taken with the input of these institutions. I don't want to say that, you know, the whole Russian policy is the area of the academic research. No, definitely not. Very often the decisions are asystemic or non-systemic, very voluntary, very often, unfortunately, because this is the political system, and prompted by some people whom I really just even don't know, but I know that they exist. But on the other hand, you know, just, it's the thing. I remember once, you know, a military analyst from the Ministry of Defense, he told me, ah, it's good that the Chinese have acquired nuclear weapons. Now they will think responsibly. This is, you know, the thing that we are trying to discuss and to help with other people to think responsibly.
Thank you. Professor Cross, would you do us the honor to wrap up this panel?
I think the final word would be, there's so much at stake right now, and not only for Montenegro's future in this year, but for the international European security community and architecture with implications for broader global security. So the decisions that are made, the responses have potentially enormous consequences. We need to be very careful, bring our best minds, people with good intentions that we could find everywhere to try to do the best that we can. And we haven't talked much about Ukraine and sort of the future. How will this play out? How will it develop? How, in times of limited resources, the United States, NATO, the European Union can contribute to help help Ukraine in addressing the economic problems, the very deep economic problems, the problems with capacity. Where do these resources come from? How can we be effective? What is the best solution? There's a lot to be discussed there too. So that's my final,
thank you.
I'm very concerned.
Thank all of you for great debate. Thank you too as well.